Welcome to Meeta Podcast. It gives me immense pleasure to share this invaluable knowledge which I have learned through various masters. In this podcast, we are going to share some of their work. In my 8-year spiritual journey, I have traveled over 60,000 kilometers and been blessed to learn from many masters of this century, whether alive or not in the body. This work is dedicated to all of those and to those who are listening to it. It would be better if you can hear this in a silence with your earplugs on. Let's begin the journey of inner self. Ashtavakra Gita, Podcast Day 1, Introduction. Janak asked, "O Lord, how does one attain wisdom and how does liberation happen? And how is non-attachment attended? Please tell me this." Ashtavakra replied, "O beloved, if you want liberation, then renounce the vishayas, the passion as visha, poison, and take forgiveness, innocence, compassion, contentment, and truth as nectar. You are neither earth, nor air, nor fire, nor water, nor ether. To attain liberation, know yourself as the witness, conscious of all this. If you can separate yourself from the physical body and rest in consciousness, then this very moment you will be happy, at peace, and free from bondage. You are not a Brahmin or other caste. You are not in any way of 4 stages of life. You are not perceived by eyes or other senses. Unattached and without form, you are the witness of the whole universe. Know this and be happy. O expensive one, religion and atheism, happiness and misery, all are of the mind. They are not for you. You are not the doer nor the enjoyer. You have always been liberated. We are embarking on a rare journey. A man has many scriptures, but none comparable to Gita of Ashtavakra. The most important thing is that neither society, nor politics, nor any other institution of human life has had any influence on the sayings of Ashtavakra. They are such a pure expression, transcending emotions, transcending time and death. There is nothing comparable. Perhaps this is why Ashtavakra Gita, the Ashtavakra Samhita, has not had much impact. Ashtavakra is not for synthesis. He is a man of truth. He speaks the truth just as it is, without any artifice or coloring. He is not concerned about the listener. He does not care whether his listener will understand or not. Such a pure expression of truth has never happened anywhere before, nor has it ever happened again. Ashtavakra's message is crystal clear. You won't be able to add even a small bit of your own interpretation to it. Hence, people have not written commentaries on Ashtavakra Gita. There is no scope for writing commentary. There is no way to distort or twist it. Your mind has no chance to add anything. Ashtavakra has given such an expression that no one has been able to add or take anything off from it. Even though centuries have passed, It is not easy to give such a perfect expression. Such a skill with the words is very difficult to come by. This is the first thing you need to keep in mind. Such crystal clarity, an expression like an open sky with no cloud in sight. You cannot see any forms. Only when you drop all forms, become disidentified with all the forms and get connected with the formless, you will be able to comprehend Ashtavakra. If you really want to understand Ashtavakra, you will have to descend into the depth of meditation. No commentary, no interpretation will be of any help. Before we enter the sutras, it is necessary to understand few things about Ashtavakra. Not much is known, as he was neither a social nor a political man. So no historical record exists. Only few incidents are known, and they are just wondrous, hardly believable. But if you understand them deeply, the significance will be relieved. The significance will be revealed. The first incident happened before Ashtakra was born. Nothing is known what came afterwards, but this is an incident while he was still in the womb. His father, who was a great scholar, would recite Vedas every day while Ashtavakra listened from the womb. One day, a voice came from the womb saying, "Stop it. This is all nonsense. There is no wisdom whatsoever in this. Mere words. Just a collection of words. Is wisdom found in the scriptures? Wisdom is within oneself. Is the truth found in words? The truth is within oneself." Naturally, his father was enraged. First of all, he was a father, and on top of that, a scholar. And his son, hidden in the womb, was saying such thing. Not even born yet. He exploded in anger, became engulfed in fire. The father ego has been hit. A scholar ego. He was a great pandit, a great debater, knowledgeable in scripture. In anger, he uttered a curse. When born, the boy would be deformed. His limbs would be bent in 8 parts. Hence, his name Ashtavakra means one whose body has 8 bends. He was born crippled in 8 places. 8 places hunchback like a camel. In a rage, his father deform his body. There are other stories like this. It is said that Buddha was born standing up. His mother was standing under a tree. She gave birth standing, and he was born standing up. He didn't fall to the ground but started walking. He took 7 spaces, and on the 8th he stood and proclaimed the 4 noble truths. That life is suffering. He took just 7 steps on earth and proclaimed that life is suffering. That is possible to be free from suffering. That there is a way to become free from suffering. That there is a state free of suffering. The state of Nirvana. About Lhasa, the story is that he was born old. That he was born 80 years old, that he remained in the womb 80 years. Since he had no desire to do anything, he had no desire to leave the womb. Since he had no wants, he didn't want to come into the world either. When he was born, he had white hair, an old man of 80 years. Zarathustra's story is that he burst out laughing as soon as he was born. but Ashtavakra has defeated them all. These are all events after birth. Ashtavakra made his full statement before he was even born. These stories are significant. These stories contain the essence, the essential treasure of the life of these masters. Buddha's story contains the essence of what he taught his whole life. Buddha taught the Eightfold Path, so he took 7 steps and stopped on the 8. There are 8 parts in all. The last step is that of right samadhi, and only in that state of samadhi is the whole truth of life is known. So he proclaimed the 4 noble truth. Lao Tzu was born old. People live 80 years, still they don't have the understanding Lao Tzu had at the birth. Do you see people becoming intelligent just by getting old? Getting old and becoming intelligent are not synonymous. At a ripe old age, even hair can ripen to pure white. Lao Tzu's story simply says that if there is urgency, intensity in one's life, then what might take 80 years can happen in one moment. If one understanding is intense, it can happen in one moment, and without pure intelligence, it does not happen even in 80 years. Don't look for historical facts in these stories. It is not that they happened this way, but there is a very profound meaning in these stories. You have a seed. When you look at the seed, you can find no indication of the flowers that will grow from it. There is not even a clue of what it can be. Will it be lotus, blossoming in the water, but remaining untouched by it, dancing in the rays of sun? And the sun too may become jealous of its beauty, of its tenderness, of its incomparable glory and grace. Its perfume will fly into the sky. Looking at the seed, this cannot be known. Looking at the seed, one cannot imagine, cannot even guess. But one day it happens. So we think in 2 ways. Either we can hold tight to the seed and say, what is not visible in the seed cannot happen in the lotus either. It's an illusion, it's a trick, it's a lie. This is a standpoint of those who we call rational skeptics. They say what is not visible in the seed cannot be present in the flower. Something is wrong. Buddha returned to his village and the father. What the world could see, the father could not see. The world was experiencing illumination. The news was spreading far and wide. People began coming from distant countries. But when Buddha came back to his home after 12 years, his father said, I cannot still forgive you. Though what you did was wrong, tormentous us, you have certainly done a crime. I have a father of heart. I will forgive you. The doors are open for you. Throw away this begging bowl. Remove this monk's cloth. None of this will do here. Come back. This kingdom is yours. I have become old. Who is going to look after it? Much childishness has gone on. Now stop all this play. Buddha said, please look at me. The one who left has not returned. Someone else has come. The one who was born in your house has not come back. Someone else is here. The seed has returned as a flower. Look deeply. The father said, you are going to teach me. I have known you since the day you were born. Go and deceive others. Go and lecture other people and delude them. You cannot deceive me. I repeat again, I know you perfectly well. Don't try to teach me. I am willing to forgive you. Buddha said, You say you know me. I didn't even know myself before. Only recently, the rays of light descended and I have come to know myself. Excuse me, but I have to say that the one you saw is not me. Whatever you saw is not me. You saw the outer shell, but you did not look inside me. I was born out of you, but you did not create me. I came via you as a traveler comes via certain route. But what do the travelers and the road have to do with each other? Suppose that tomorrow the road says, I know you. Your being has come from me, just as you are saying. I existed before you. I have been on this journey for many lives. I certainly passed through you as I have passed through others. Others too have been my father. Others too have been my mother. But my being is completely separate. It is very difficult, extremely difficult. If you saw the seed, you cannot believe the flower is in front of you. One way looking of this, trustful, the rational, the skeptical. They say, we know the seed, so this flower is not possible. We know the mud, how can lotus come from it? It is all false, a dream, an illusion. He must have fallen into kind of hypnosis. Someone deceived him, some magic, some spell. This is one way. The other way is of trust, of a lover, the devotee, of the heart filled with empathy. He sees the flower and from the flower begins traveling backwards. He says, when the flower has become so fragrant, when such a radiance appears in flower, when there is such a beauty in the flower, when such a fresh innocence is seen in the flower, then certainly it must have been present in the seed. Because it is not possible that what is present in the flower was not already in the seed. It is not that these stories actually happened. Those who saw flower bloom in Ashtavakra concluded that what has happened today must have also been present yesterday. It was hidden, screened behind a veil. What is here in the end must have been present in the beginning also. What is seen at the moment of death also have been present at the moment of birth. Otherwise, how could it arise? So one way is to look backwards from the flower, another way is to look forward from the seed. If you look carefully, their essence is the same. Their foundation is the same. But what a difference, like between earth and sky. The one who knows the seed says, how can what is not in the seed be present in the flower? This is his argument. The one who knows the flower says the same thing. He says, what is in the flower should be in seed too. They have the same argument, but each has a different way of looking. Whoever hears Ashtavakra story will immediately cry false, impossible. Of course, those who wrote this story know that no one ever speaks from the womb. They are only saying that what finally appears must have been present in the womb. The voice that later blossomed must have been present in some deep place in the womb. Otherwise, from where did it blossom? From where did it come? Do things just come out of the void? There is a reason behind everything. We may not have been able to see it, but must have been present. All these stories indicate this. The second incident known about Ashtavakra happened when he was still 12 years old. Only these two incidents are known. The third is Ashtavakra Gita, or as some call it, Ashtavakra Samhita. When Ashtavakra was 12 years old, Janak hosted a huge debating conference. Janak was an emperor and he invited the pandits of the whole country to debate on the scriptures. He had 1,000 cows placed at the palace gate and had the horns of the cows plated with gold and decorated them with jewels. He proclaimed, "Whoever is victorious shall take the possession of these cows." It was a great debate. Ashtavakra's father also participated. As dusk was falling, the message came to Ashtavakra that his father was losing. He had already defeated all others, but he was about to be defeated by a pandit named Vadin. Receiving this message, Ashtavakra went to palace. The hall was decorated. The debate was in its final stage, and the decisive moment was fast approaching. His father's defeat was complete, foregone conclusion. He was on the very edge of defeat. The pandit saw Ashtavakra as he entered the royal court. They were all learned scholars. His body was bent and deformed in its places. He had just to move and anyone would start laughing. His very movement was laughing matter. The whole meeting broke into laughter. Ashtavakra also roared with laughter. Janak asked, "Everyone else is laughing. I can understand why they laugh. But why did you laugh, my son?" Ashtavakra said, "I am laughing because truth is being decided in the conference of butchers." The man must have been extraordinary. What are all these Skinners doing here? Deep silence fell over the meeting. "Butchers? Skinners?" The king asked, "What do you mean?" Ashtavakra said, "It is simple and straightforward. They only see skin. They don't see me. It is difficult to find a man more pure and simple than me. But they don't see this. They see a bent and deformed body. They are skinners. They judge by the skin. Your Majesty, in the curve of temple, is the sky curved? Or when a pot is smashed, is the sky smashed? The sky is beyond change. My body is twisted, but I am not. Look at the one within. You can't find anything more straight and pure." It was very startling declaration. There must have been pin drop silence. Janak was impressed, astonished. Absolutely right. Why had he gathered a crowd of Skinners here? He became repentant. He felt guilty that he too had laughed. The day the king couldn't manage to say anything. But the following day, when he was out on his morning ride, he saw Ashtavakra on the way. Janak dismounted from his horse and fell at his feet. The day before, in front of everyone, he couldn't find the courage. The day before, he had said, "Why do you laugh, my son?" Ashtavakra was a boy of 12 years, and Janak had considered his age. This day, he didn't notice the age. This day, he had gone down from his horse and fell at Ashtavakra's feet. Spared, entangled in prostration, he said, "Please visit the palace and satisfy my eagerness for the truth. O Lord, be so gracious as to come to my home. I have understood. I couldn't sleep the whole night. you spoke truly. What depth of understanding have those who recognize only the body? They are debating the being, but the attraction and repulsion for the body still arises. Hate and attraction still arises. They are looking at death while talking of the deathless. I am blessed that you have come and disturbed me, that you broke my sleep. Please come to palace. Janak had the palace decorated magnificently. He welcomed Ashtavakra and seated him on a golden throne, this 12-year-old Ashtavakra. Then he puts his question to him. The first sutra is Janak inquiry. Janak asked Ashtavakra, explain. Beyond this, nothing is known about Ashtavakra. And there is no need to know more. It is more than enough. Diamonds are not many. Only pebbles and rocks are so common. A single diamond is enough. These are two small incidents. One before birth, a voice from the womb with proclamation. What madness have you fallen into? Confused by scripture, by words. Wake up. This is not wisdom. This is all borrowed. It is all the mud of the mind, not the experience. There isn't the slightest bit of reality in it. How long are you going to delude yourself? And the second incident, the pandits in the palace laughing and Ashtavakra saying that in the life there are two visions. One is to see being, another is to see skin. Butcher sees skin, the wise see being. Have you noticed a shoemaker doesn't look at your face? He only look at your shoes. Actually, a shoemaker can know everything about you just by looking at your shoes. How your economic situation is, if you are successful or failure, how your luck is, the condition of the shoes tells him your autobiography is written on your shoes. The shoemaker can read it. If the shoes are shiny, if the shoes are clean and new, the shoemaker is happy to meet you. For him, your shoes are the proof of your being. A tailor looks at clothes. Seeing how you dress, he understands your situation. All have their own narrow vision. Only one full of his own being sees being. He had no fixed vision. He has only seen darshan. One more small incident. It is not about Ashtavakra, but about Ramakrishna and Vivekananda. But Ashtavakra is not involved in it. After this, we will enter the Ashtavakra Gita's sutras. When Vivekananda came to Ramakrishna, his name was still Narendranath. Later on, Ramakrishna named him Vivekananda. When he came to Ramakrishna, he was extremely argumentative, an atheist, a rationalist. He wanted proof for everything. There are some things that have no proof. It cannot be helped. There is no proof for godliness. It is, yet there is no proof for love. It is, and yet there is no proof. There is no proof for beauty. It is, and yet there is no proof. If I say, look how beautiful this ironwood trees are, and you say, I don't see any beauty. Trees are just trees, prove it. It will be difficult. How can one prove they are beautiful? To be beautiful, you need to a sense of beauty. There is no other way. You need eyes. There is no other way. It is reported that Majnu said, to know Layla, you will need the eyes of Majnu. It is true. To see Layla, there is no other way. The king of his area called Majnu and said, "You are mad. I know you are Layla, an ordinary girl, jet black, nothing special. I feel sorry for you. So here are 12 girls from my palace. They are the most beautiful women of the country. You can choose anyone you like. Seeing you cry, my heart also cries." Majnu looked at them and said, "There is no Layla among them. They cannot be compared to my Layla. They are not even worth the dust of her feet." The king said, "Majnu, you are mad." Majnu said, "That may be so, but I must tell you one thing. To see Layla, you will need the eyes of Majnu. Majnu is right. To see the beauty of trees, you need an eye for art. There is no other proof. If one wants to know love, one will need the heart of a lover. There is no other proof. And godliness is the collective name of all the beauty, all the love, and all the truth of the universe. For it, unwavering consciousness is needed. A witnessing is needed, where no word remains, no thought remains, no wave arises, where no mental dust remains, and the mirror of consciousness is perfectly pure. What is the proof?" Vivekananda told Ramakrishna, "I want proof. If God exists, then prove it." Ramakrishna looked at Vivekananda. This youth had great promise, great potential. Much was ready to happen within him. There was a great treasure within which Vivekananda was unacquainted. Ramakrishna looked into, peered into the past lives of this youth. Vivekananda had come carrying a great treasure of integrity, but it was suppressed under his logic. Seeing this, a cry of anguish and compassion must have risen from Ramakrishna's heart. He said, "Forget all this. We will talk about proof and such thing later on. I have become a little old. I have difficulty reading. You are young. Your eyes are still strong. Read from the book lying there." It was Ashtavakra Gita. "Read a little out loud to me. It is said that Vivekananda saw nothing wrong in this." This fellow was not requesting anything special. He read 3 or 4 sutras and every cell being trembling. He started to panic and he said, "I cannot read on." Ramakrishna insisted, "Go ahead and read. What harm can it be in there? How can this book hurt you? You are young, your eyes are still fresh, and I am old. It is hard for me to read. I must hear this book. Read it out to me." It is said that Vivekananda kept on reading aloud from the book and disappeared in meditation. Ramakrishna had seen the great potential of this youth, a very promising potential like that of Bodhisattva, who one day or other is destined to become Buddha. Sooner or later, no matter how much he wanders, he is approaching Buddhahood. Why did Ramakrishna ask that he read the Ashtavakra Gita out loud to him? Because there is no pure statement of truth. If this word penetrate you, they will start awakening you. Your sleeping soul. These words will thrill you. These words will fill you with ecstasy. These words will shock you. With this word, the revolution can take place within you. Thank you for listening. This is today's podcast. If you have any questions, or if you want to get more understanding on this, please do write comment below and I will try to answer it. Thank you and namaskar.